And as you know, John Gustafson recently published a book called The End of Error, Unum, in which he proposes a new floating point format called Unums, which is short for universal number, and as a replacement for conventional floating point. And as the book's title suggests, he makes some rather strong claims about what Unums can do. So, for example, that they're easier to use than floating point, more accurate, less demanding on energy, on memory and bandwidth, or power, and guaranteed to give bitwise identical results, and in most situations, faster. So, in many places throughout the book, John acknowledges the contributions of William Kahn to floating point arithmetic, of course. And so, it uses many of Kahn's examples throughout the book about how floating point can go wrong to illustrate the potential advantages of Unum. So, for example, one section of Gustafson's book is entitled The Wrath of Kahn. And another section entitled Another Kahn Contract. So, indeed, the great debate is foreshadowed in section 18.1, where Gustafson responds at length to a challenge proposed by Professor Kahn to an early draft of the book. Now, this development has not stopped with this, and John has continued to develop these ideas. And most recently, he's proposed something called SORN, for sets of real numbers. And I believe he will explain that new proposal here, and that will also be the subject of the debate. So the way this is going to be organized is as follows. So each speaker, starting with John, will get 30 minutes just to explain their position. And you can only ask explanatory questions, clarifying questions. Debate questions will come later. And then Professor Kahn will get his 30 minutes. And then we'll have 30 minutes of a free-for-all. But I'm the moderator, and I will make sure everybody sticks to their 30 minutes, and we'll ask questions, and the two gentlemen can debate on it. So without further ado, it's John.
All right. Thanks for this opportunity. It looks like I'm going to have to advance.
If people move closer, they'll find it easier to read the slides.
So you were going to... Okay.
So I also have a take on why this debate is occurring. It's a little bit different from what you just heard. The end of error, Unum Computing had dozens of reviewers, which included David Bailey, and Horst Simon, colleagues of Dr. Kahn's at Berkeley, also Gordon Bell, John Gunnels, who has won 3 Gordon Bell Awards, and about a half a dozen other PhD numerical analysts. And the book was critiqued not just based on its mathematical content, but also on its style and its approach, since it was aimed at the, let's say, pre-college reader who did not necessarily have to know calculus in order to understand a lot about it.
Can you mic up just a little bit?
Higher?
Yeah.
How's that?
I think that's
it. Okay. Yeah, so I was purposely targeting pre-calculus people, but people who had a good high school education in mathematics. So, Professor Kahn has had that manuscript since November 2013, at least a preliminary version, part one. And we had email conversations about it, but all email cut off, strangely, in July 2014. We went back and forth. And I posed a counter question to him. I said, can you solve this one? And then the line went dead. I didn't know what I said. But it's possible that health problems were involved. But I was really missing his contribution because I wanted to make sure he was on top of everything I was about to publish and would be able to give me his feedback. Then this happened. Book came out in February, and fairly quickly became the number one bestseller in numerical systems. Admittedly a small category, but there's 4,000 books on numerical systems on Amazon, and he got 8 reviews, five out of 5 stars, and they kept running out of the thing. They couldn't keep it in stock. And I think this is probably what aroused the attention of Dr. Kahn, because people are actually reading this thing. Maybe we should do something to caution people about it. So, The Wrath of Kahn, a bitter blog. As you may know, Dr. Kahn no longer really submits papers to journals, at least not very often. What he does instead is he writes blog articles, and some of them are very colorful, let's say. How Java's floating point hurts everyone everywhere, and things like that. And he prepares these diatribes, and he blogs them, and usually labels them as work in progress. I don't know if that means he changes them occasionally or not. But the issue we're discussing today, the future of number representation on computers, I think is too important to be left to the bickering of two old men. So, he was kind enough to share with me the 38-page attack he wants to post about the end of error, you know, arithmetic. And so I was able to see some of the things he plans to say. I expect him probably to be covering some of these things today. Since this is the only thing that's really finished, I won't even be talking about what are now called Unum's Type 1 or Unum's 1.0. I don't have any material prepared about 2.0 because, in fact, I'm not finished with it yet, ready to show the world. It's still in progress. So I will respond in part here to the bitter blog that I have seen. You see the table of contents there. I'm sure you can't read those words. First of all, I think everybody has this reaction. Variable bit size is just too darn expensive. Be able to change the widths and sizes of representations is going to be a headache for hardware designers and for software and for storage and so on. And I always sigh and say, well, it doesn't have to be variable size. You can do these things fixed size. But if you do have to use variable size, you don't need an additional set of pointers in order to pack and unpack these things. There's these three bits, three fields, the U tag. They serve as a pointer to the next unit. So you untangle it as a linked list. They already have the overhead necessary for packing and unpacking. No additional bits required. So, chapter 7. The title of the chapter is Fixed Size Minimum Storage. And I just don't know how people can miss it. It's 93 pages, 93 to 102. Talks about how you can make sure you can fill matrix arrays with UNIMs and still be able to have constant time add access to anything and do exactly what you would do with current arithmetic. No problems. There is still energy and power savings when you unpack things, leaving a few bits unused. Hardware designers know how to turn off bits with the absolutely certain field within, say, a 64-bit register are not going to be touched. So even within the chip, you can still get energy and power savings in unpacked form. This brings up an example that Khan calls a bogus analogy. Here's what I put, the version of it. In Courier, 16-point type, UNIMs offer the same trade-off versus floats as variable width versus fixed width typefaces, harder for the design engineer and more logic for the computer, but superior for everyone else in terms of usability, compactness, and overall cost. Do that in times, and notice how much space it takes up on the screen, or how much space it would take up if printed. Everybody I know who has read this understood the analogy. Except Professor Khan. He said, bunkum! Gustus in his confused way text is printed and displayed. It would have occupied more DRAM memory, not less. Yeah, it takes more DRAM memory to take less space on a piece of paper or on a screen, which might be the most valuable resource these days. So, I was saying that if you have more memory, you can do certainly tighter fitting of things, but they only have to take up the amount of space that they each require, instead of everything has to be as big as the largest letter. So the same way, if you have variable size arithmetic, you can shrink and adjust, and in general, you will save space using only as many bits as are needed in memory for the numbers. So I have not met any other reader who misunderstood this and then attacked it. But here's the fallacy, and it's a willful misunderstanding technique. You take something I've written, or anybody's written, and misread it to be something that's clearly a false statement. Then you attack that, even that's not what I said. So as I read through this 38-page document, imagine 38 pages of text just like this one. I didn't say that. So he's attacking things that were not the position I was taking at all. I want to go over a classic Khan example. The area of the triangle is very, very skinny. So let's take a triangle size A, B, and C, where C is the long side, and A and B are just barely, barely more than half the length of C. So it pops up a little bit, like buckled concrete in the sun. And it's only 3 ulps larger. And then you're going to try to use the formula, the classic geometric formula of a square of S minus A, S minus B, S minus C, after finding the sum A plus B plus C over 2. And this is hazardous because of that. S and C are very close. In fact, they're only 6 ulps apart. So you're going to be taking two very similar numbers and subtracting them. Not necessarily a problem if it's exact. You don't lose any information if those two are properly represented. But if there's any problem that you rounded S when you calculated it, that's going to amplify the relative error in a massive way. So an IEEE quad precision, let's pull out all the stops and use the best stuff you can get right now. 128 bits, 34 decimals. We'll let A equals B with 7 halves and add 3 ulps. An ulp is 2 to the negative 111th power. That's a really small number. And C equals exactly 7. And just to make it a little bit more interesting, let's say that the units of length are light years. So 7 light years away, that's like Alpha Centauri in each direction, our nearest star. 3 ulps is 1/200th the diameter of a proton. Amazingly, that manages to pop the triangle up by roughly the width of a standard door, 85 centimeters. So finally, we have a number we can kind of comprehend. And that area of that extremely long strip is about 55 times the area of the Earth. It's getting almost up to the surface area of one of the gas giants like Neptune. So here is the answer correct to 34 decimals in square light years. Just remember the first few decimals, please. It's easy to remember, 3.14 times 10 to the minus 16th square light years. That's what we should get. The quad precision float result is it gets one digit right. A lot of work for one digit. 3.6 times 10 to the minus 16th. About 15% too high. That's, in terms of ulps, that's 250 some peta ulps. The result does not admit any error nor bounded. It gives no warning to the user. You are expected to do error analysis in order to figure out that this happened to you because it's completely silent. Nothing protects you from this error. Professor Kahn suggests that you sort the signs so that they're A greater than B greater than C, and then apply this formula, which is algebraically equivalent. I would love to know how many hours it took him to find that formula, or how many hours it would take you to figure out that formula.
Half an hour.
Half an hour of a Berkeley professor's time, conservatively, let's suppose your time is worth $300 an hour. I think it's probably more. So it took, cost about $150 to get that formula out, in order to save the computer from having to do a little bit more work. That's now provably within 11 ulps of the correct area, but it takes hours to figure out that kind of an approach. It also uses twice as many operations. I have no objection to using twice as many operations. We've got operations to burn. But that's not the issue. It's the people cost of the approach. It's the wrong direction. We need to make things easier for users. Let's try using arithmetic, and let's make sure that we're not cheating. So I'm not going to use any more than 128 bits, period. We're limited on the quads, 128 bits per number, but it can adjust. It will sometimes use less than 128, but it will never go over. The exponent is more flexible. It can go from 1 to 16 bits, so I've actually got a bigger dynamic range. The fraction can be 1 to 120 bits plus the hidden bit. That's higher precision than quad. The result is a rigorous bound accurate to 31 decimals. The area is strictly bounded by those two numbers. They don't start even differing. You see the orange over there until the 32nd decimal. I didn't have to change the formula. The area of that bound, the error, is a square about 8 nanometers on its side. So we're getting down to about the limits of present lithography in order to find out the error in binding the same that has 55 times the area of planet Earth. Okay. So in summary, let's take a look at quad precision IEEE floats versus units, also 128 bits. The dynamic range is almost the square of what you get with quad precision floats. Instead of 34 decimal units, I could have up to 38.8. And then trying it on the triangle, I used an average of 90 bits. They shrink. And the result is the float result says area exactly equals this wrong number. Versus units, which say it's definitely between these two numbers, provably. The type of information loss in the case of float is invisible error. Very hard to debug. When I actually did this example, I used units to do the quad. I just set the exponent to the right size, the fraction to the right size, and simulated with my environment. And at the point where you get the rounding error, where suddenly 6 ulps becomes 8 ulps, is instantly visible. It was so easy to spot. It was no problem. Whereas, I think if it just keeps on cranking away and always getting what looks like 34 decimals of precision, you're going to have to walk through it one step at a time, very laboriously. So, by having more information, it makes it easier to debug and figure out what's going on in your computation. Here's another example of, well, just rewrite the code this way. Now, I did an example just to show why round and nearest might not be random, and also how the system could automatically adjust to give you higher accuracy and manage self-managed accuracy. The simplest example I could think of was just count to a billion. Just keep on adding one, a billion times, and see how you do with floating point arithmetic. Floating point floats, of course, can represent the number 1 billion, but they will get stuck, as we heard in an earlier talk. In trying to count to a billion, IEEE floats get stuck at 2 to the 24th, 16 million something. They can't get any higher because if you add one, it keeps on rounding down. Well, this is a well-known problem, and Dr. Kahn says in his write-up, compensated summation will be illustrated by application to a silly sum Gustafson uses on page 120 to justify what units do, as intervals do, namely convey numerical uncertainty via their widths. I don't think that's silly at all. I like to know when something has suddenly lost its ability to give me a precise answer. And that's actually not what this section was about. But let's try it. So, this is a screenshot from Kahn's paper with n equals 10 to the 9th, compensated summation, all are floats. So the sum, now you've introduced two variables, old sum and compensation, and you keep track of this. Your summation in a program often will be scattered all over the program. So for every sum you're accumulating, you're going to have to keep two auxiliary variables like this and keep track of them. What do you suppose this does for the maintainability of the code and the portability and the chance that you might have made a bug somewhere, made an error? I'd say it was sky high. So I coded it up in Mathematica exactly as you see here. It's a slight translation from whatever pidgin language that is to Mathematica, but I think it's exactly what you see. And I summed from 1 to 10. I got the number 2036. I tried adding 1 plus 1. It gave me 4. I tried going all the way to a billion. Nan. I think sum minus old sum equals infinity minus infinity. It said not a number. What is going on? This is a fail. He got an error when he coded it up. And he put right there in the code, in the text. So even Kahn didn't get it right. Rewriting code to try to compensate for these things and say, let's rearrange all this stuff, is very error-prone. It also makes your code completely cryptic to anybody who's trying to understand, what are you doing? You just won't be able to see it. Plus, it gets huge, potentially huge mistakes. So an approach that uses more coding effort and three times as many bits to produce a wildly wrong answer does not impress me. Examples like this need to be tested, not merely asserted. He says, sum equals 10 to the 9th exactly. No, it's not. I wonder how many other things he says, this is true for this formula. When I wrote the book, I did not use a word processor. I used Mathematica to generate the book as a computer program. All of the examples, therefore, are computed output. So any mistake it would make would be like transcribing a result somewhere into the comment field. I might make a mistake doing that, but other than that, it's all pretty much bomb-proof. Now I had one of my favorite examples from Kahn is, I called it his monster, and that's meant as a flattering term, because it's a really clever example. But it's a very tough one for floats. There's three functions, T, Q, and G. I got the letters right this time, I think. And Q should be identically zero, but floats can't do the square roots and the reciprocals exactly, so they tend to get a little slop. You square that number in the bottom function G, and that means you're going to get something a little bit bigger than zero. And then you use the removable singularity function, e to the x minus, e to the z minus 1 all over z, and floats will tend to get zero most of the time. They might get lucky and actually get 1, which is the correct answer. Okay, so when I coded this up, I used the approximate equal sign, which actually means intersects. So if a unit interval intersects 0, then that's the wobbly, not nowhere equal sign. I didn't use exact equality there, shown in bright blue, just the way he showed it in bright blue, because he wanted to emphasize that I was cheating. So he got bent out of shape by that. So I coded up with an equal sign, and you can see right there, if z equals 0, 1, else e to the z minus 1 over z. I don't know how much more direct I could code exactly what he wanted as his example problem. The other three lines are just putting it in unum form with unum operations. Here's the result. Instead of getting exactly 1, I got 1 plus an whole. I showed you the first nine and the last nine, but it's very boring. The list of 10,000 numbers, it's all exactly one and an all. And they're all the form 1 plus epsilon, and it's rounded on, this is a half-open interval. It includes number 1, and it's a little bit bigger, goes a little bit to the right, but it's never 0. Never makes that mistake. Now, he would have found that out if he'd tried. He has access to all my code at his fingertips, as do all of you. It's a free download. Comes with, just go to the CRC publication site and use it. Or you can get it in Julia, or there's about 5 versions of the Unum arithmetic now in Julia on the web. One in Python, that's a line-by-line transcription of the prototype. C versions are popping up everywhere, C++. It won't be long before name your language is going to have some Unum support from somebody. So I don't know why he didn't just try these things, and he said, oh, that's not going to work. He speculated that it would fail. So he made one up, and I feel so honored. I've earned my first targeted, this will break Unums, from Dr. Khan. What he did was he added on a number 10 to the negative 300th power, all raised to the power of 10,000 times x plus 1, which could be as large, or I should say as small, as 10 to the negative 30 million. So I'm very flattered that he thought it would take a number like 10 to the negative 30 billion to break Unum arithmetic, and or at least slow it down, make it take an intractable amount of time. What, if anything, does Unum computing get for this? How long does it take? It cannot be soon nor simply 1.0. I bet. I had absolutely no trouble handling this, and it didn't slow it down one bit. For a very simple reason. What he called that very small number is immediately turned into the Unum 0 to epsilon, open interval. It's not 0. It's too small to represent. This is the way Unums handle what normally would become underflow. They don't underflow. They don't overflow. They don't round. They just say it's in that interval, 0 to epsilon, and I will keep track of it that way. You want to exponentiate it? Fine. You'll be getting, once again, 1 to 1 plus epsilon. It didn't go any slower. It didn't require high precision. It, I guess you could say, it just gave up. It didn't even attempt to represent this number. And Khan referred to it as an infinitesimal, which I think is a strange use of the word infinitesimal, since it's clearly a number, not an infinitesimal. Anyway, here's what I call an inconvenient infinity. And I just was finding a very simple example. As I say, this is a very broad audience book. So I said, what's the area of a circle? Let's give it an arc of a circle, multiply by 4, and see how close to pi we can get with 1 decimal of precision. With very, very crude limits. So if you pick a point on the left, it will kind of like a burning fuse move over to the right and close the gap of what is evaluates to x squared plus y squared equals 1. All you have to know is how to multiply and how to test for equality with 1. The error tends to be 1 over n, and it's a rigorous bound. This works on any continuous function. It doesn't care. In fact, with a slight modification, you can even work on discontinuous functions. So I was looking for generality, not for how tight can I make the bound. So here is one of the things that Khan wrote up in his attack on my book. He mentioned that the midpoint rule has an error term associated with it. The trapezoidal rule has an error associated with it. And if you use those two together, you can put a, quote, bound about numerical evaluation of intervals. Pretty good. It does require that the second derivative exist and be bounded throughout. And as I read through his write-up, he mentioned several times f prime is bounded throughout. And then he sort of noticed that it's not. It's not bounded. For the quarter circle, it goes to infinity. To my astonishment, he used the formula anyway. He used the bound, ignoring the fact that it's this bound plus infinity is less than infinity. You can't do that. If my students do something like this, I take off at least half points on the test. Okay. There were very clear conditions for this theorem to work. And he ignored them because he wanted a nice tight bound. He also said that my method is order n squared, which I think if you just look at the method, you can see it's not order n squared. I do give an earlier method which populates all the squares underneath and quickly say, that's not the right way to do it, you do it this way. But he's still stuck with, oh, that's a really slow way. It would be very, very slow to just fill in all the squares. There's too many mistakes to really cover here, but perhaps the biggest one is he says, the book claims it ends all error. It does nothing of the kind. It says it ends a specific kind of error. It's the error of rounding and sampling. always substituting a specific exact number when you really wanted something different. And he says, unums are target intervals. Well, unums subsume floats and intervals. You can use them to be floating point numbers. You can use them to be interval numbers. This is a whole environment. It's not just a number format. It's a set of rules for how to use them as well. What you can do in the scratch pad, for example. That's what gives you bitwise compatible answers. But, you know, target means too much lipstick and makeup, things like that. And when I look at these 34-digit numbers that claim to have all this precision, and only one of them is correct, I think that's the one that's wearing too much makeup. You see, unums admit what they don't know, whereas floats always claim all this precision, which might not be true. Gustafson regards calculus as evil. He is not joking. I was amazed because I used a raccoon meme that says DIY LOL on it. And I don't know how anyone could know that I'm not joking. I have invented something evil. I will call it calculus. I think most people would laugh when they see this, and that was my intent. I was trying to make a point that people tend to confuse when they're calculating and when they're using calculus. You get in a lot of trouble doing that, and there's a lot of problems that can be solved without using calculus. I wanted to kind of push the limits. How far can we go without requiring calculus? Anyway, I would say in a few places that grade school math would suffice. And you say, that's not grade school, that's trigonometry. And, well, 12th grade is a grade. 11th grade is a grade. That's why they're called grades. If I meant elementary school, I would have said elementary school. This is not a book for elementary school math. Unums will cost thousands of extra transistors. Really? Which will cost thousands of a penny? This is 2016. This is not 1985. A 1,000 transistor will cost you roughly 1/100 cent right now. And it's getting cheaper still. His approach is very inefficient. Here's a faster one that usually works. How many times have I heard that? I am so tired of methods that usually work and require an expert to tell you when they do work and when they don't work. I'm interested in very robust methods that you can hand to people who are not experts that work every time, even if it's slowly. Gustafson suffers from a misconception about floating point shared by von Neumann. It pleases me no end to share misconceptions with von Neumann. One of the ones, the exact misconception he was talking about actually is von Neumann was concerned that if you handed floating point hardware to people, they would misuse it. They would just use it blindly without doing proper error analysis, and they would get in trouble because they'd get wrong answers and they wouldn't know it. That's my misconception. I think it's perfectly accurate. Let me just give you some memes. That was computers then, 1980s. Remember those days? This is computers now. 1,000 times cheaper, 1,000 times faster. Here's what arithmetic looked like back then. Single, double, extended. Here's what arithmetic looks like now. You see my point? Isn't it time to do something about floating point arithmetic? Maybe not what I did, but something to improve the quality with a million times as much power at our fingertips? Why can't we do something to make things a little less painful for people? The biggest blind spot of all in the entire 38 pages of criticism he was levying. And watch for this when he speaks, because I hope he doesn't make it now. I say several times, remember, there is nothing floats can do that unums cannot. They are perfectly capable of mimicking every float that there is, all the IEEE floats and all the sizes in between. That's just special cases of IEEE floats. It's the last line, because I want to make sure people saw that. There's a whole chapter dedicated to this called Permission to Guess, because what you do with unums is you explicitly ask for a round operation. It doesn't happen every time. So, you don't have to throw away all these great float algorithms that we've built up over the decades. I'm not saying you should. There are many things, well, there's quite a few things you can find where a floating point algorithm is perfectly stable, it works, it's got a solid base of theory behind it, and there's absolutely no reason to use unums. In fact, unums may complicate things to the point where you really wish you didn't use them. Then just use the unum as a float. It's a superset. When you request rounding, it's very much more honest than when it happens every time without you being under control. Unums end the era of mandatory, invisible substitution of incorrect exact answers for correct answers. gives you back the control over what's going on in the calculation and makes it so visible that you have a much better chance of knowing what went wrong if something goes wrong with your calculation. It's easier to debug, far easier. Float methods are especially the way to deal with the curse of high dimensions. If you aren't careful, you do get a kind of a 2 to the nth effect when you're trying to solve something that has n degrees of freedom. Whereas maybe there's a float method like Gauss elimination that solves the equations with order n cubed. You can use that to get a first guess, and if you want to do more with it using units, you have that option. If not, you've got way more flexibility in the precision and the dynamic range than you've ever had with IEEE floats.
Sorry, you mean float or unit methods?
Did I say something wrong? Float methods, using, in other words, take a method that exists as a float method, use the units to do the float method. Use that algorithm. Use that numerical method. Like Gauss elimination does not work well with intervals. Bad idea. Okay, it just explodes. You get a huge bomb, and it's not useful. But I do mean float methods here. So use units to perform float numerical methods. You can do it. So as I look through these pages, I see things that you normally wouldn't find in a math review. And I know Invective worked for Donald Trump, but is this really the right way to discuss mathematics? I mean, every time somebody proposes, seriously, let's do something about floating point, there's this thing that in my head, I envision it kind of this way. The Lord of the Rings does not share power. Something lights up over Berkeley, and pretty soon, you know, the blogs are just darting out and saying, that's wrong, and that never worked. So I'll leave you with that, and Dr. Khan, it's all yours.
Well, while you were getting my slides up, what Charlie's done here is to take examples out of context.